This week on Maker Update, a building brick to surpass Metal Gear, the return of Bay Area Maker Faire, Dopp Kitts and Progress Bars for daily living. Hello and welcome back to Maker Update, the show where we update you with all the cool things that makers are making. I'm Tyler Weingartner and I hope you're all doing great. We've got another great show for you, so let's check out the project of the week. While looking around on printables, I came across this design for Print-a-Blok, a pretty remarkable building brick by Joe Larson, the 3D printing professor. This project has been around for a little while now, so bear with me if this is old news for you, but this is the first I've ever heard of it. There's a few things that make these bricks really special. First of all, they're 3D printable. You probably already guessed that from the name. But the design is also open source, making it easy for people to create their own unique brick designs. Another is that the bricks can be assembled in any direction. Bricks are joined together by this snap-in peg, and they can be assembled both horizontally and vertically. Finally, the design is scalable. The intended size is 16 millimeters, but the parts work perfectly well if you scale it up to jumbo sizes. Joe has several videos about the design of the bricks, but my favorite is this one where he talks about the design considerations that went into the joining peg. The peg needs to be square, so it can join any two bricks in any orthogonal direction. But it also needs to be a tight fit so the bricks aren't wobbling around. It seems simple enough starting out, but the problems compound really quickly. Print-a-Blok is fairly mature now, with tons of community-created specialty bricks and even new features like this ball and socket joint for making posable figures. The printables link and the show notes will get you in with tons of base blocks, but if you search for Print-a-Blok on Thingiverse or printables, you should find plenty to start printing and building with. Time for some news. Maker Faire Bay Area is back. The dust has barely settled after last weekend's open source, but Make Magazine has just announced that Maker Faire Bay Area will be returning this October after a four-year hiatus. No longer at the San Mateo Fairgrounds, this is a reimagining of the event at a new venue on Mare Island. The event will take place over two weekends with 3 days each, October 13th through 15th and October 20th through 22nd. The changes are intended to make the event less overwhelming, less crowded, more intimate, and easier for families. For more information like tickets and the call for makers, go to makerfaire.com. More projects. Becky Stern has a new video out on how to sew together a Dopp Kit bag. This is a brick-shaped zippered bag, ideal for carrying toiletries when you're traveling, or carrying a small toolkit, or makeup, or anything else you can think of. Becky's video has links for the pattern, tons of great tips on sewing it together, and a big revision on her wax canvas process that should make things a lot less tedious. This is a good beginner to intermediate sewing project and ideal for all kinds of upcycling, like making these out of reusable grocery bags. Over on Hackaday, I saw this project by Taylor Hay on how to turn a Baofeng handheld radio into the radio you see in the intro of Cyberpunk 2077. After hacking apart the Baofeng UV5R, he's driving the custom screen using an Arduino Mini Mega, but he's getting some extra functionality out of it as well. This isn't just cosplay for your walkie-talkie. Because he's also processing all the key inputs using the Arduino, he can program in macros for various radio functions, making it easy to access functions that were originally buried deeply in menus. You can follow Taylor's progress on the project by checking the link down in the show notes. And on Instructables, I found this Workday progress bar by Danion, Escu and Veeb Projects. This is a unique way of plotting out your workday. It makes use of a linear array of addressable LEDs that fill up as your day goes on. You can also integrate it into your Google Calendar to show various meetings and appointments that you have throughout your schedule, so you can get an at-a-glance look at how much time you have instead of staring at your clock. Given all the different options you have for addressable LEDs, this could be a fun one for you to express in lots of different ways. time for some tips and tools from How To Mechatronics, I found this guide on planetary gears. These are an increasingly popular gearing option for DIY mechanical devices, since they can deliver a ton of torque in an efficient design. And they're pretty well suited to 3D printing, so they're easy to make too. This video covers all the basics, how to understand their gear ratios, building a two-stage planetary gearbox, and how to design your own gearboxes, as well as some tips for 3D printing. Check it out. From Magpie Magazine, I found this guide on how to turn your Raspberry Pi Zero W into a USB thumb drive. This is a simple project that lets your Pi function as a storage device that's accessible over USB. The secret sauce to this project is also setting it up as a Samba server, which means you can send files to it over your network. I discovered this since I wanted a way to send files to my SLA printer in my basement without having to shuttle USB thumb drives, but you can also use this for smart TVs or any other device you want to be able to send files to. It's a quick tutorial and it's easy to follow. And finally, we have a video from PlayStation breaking down the features of their Access controller. Like the name says, this is a game controller with accessibility features at the forefront of its design. Each of the buttons can be swapped to a different shape and with a different button label. That's important because each button input can be mapped to any controller function. There's also a thumbstick that can extend from the main housing, and the thumbstick interface can be swapped out entirely. There's also four 3.5mm jacks for additional inputs. It's unclear from this announcement if PlayStation plans to release CAD files to help people design their own button shapes, but I imagine the controller accessibility community will be quick to reverse engineer their own if they don't. Lots of cool interface ideas in this one, and I'm excited to see all the different ways that companies are embracing accessibility and making games more accessible to more people. For this week's Digi-Key Spotlight, we've got a double dose of Becky Stern with the latest video in her Teaching Electronics series. In this video, she wants to help you get your first project connected to the internet. She starts you off with easy, high-reward projects like cheer lights and controllable LEDs with software like WLED. But she also takes you through the basics of making your own internet-reactive projects using backends like Arduino Cloud and If This Then That. Check it out. All right, and that is going to do it for this week's show. I hope you enjoyed it. If you did, give us a thumbs up, leave us a comment, and hit subscribe with the bell so you won't miss the next one. I'd love to know what you think of the return of Maker Faire Bay Area. And as always, great big thanks to Digi-Key for making this show possible and you for watching. Take care. We'll see you soon.